Chapter 2, Themis's Journal. The events recorded in this journal are the true accounts as I have remembered them. Where the events are recollections of my own eyewitness account, I have provided them. Where the events are clarifications of facts that I have learned after their occurrence, I have edited the record accordingly. I guess that the best place to start, or the first place to start about these series of events, is to give some exposition about my powers. Why it is important to understand these phenomena is that many of my powers are internal to my own mind. So, from a linear perspective, it will be necessary and sufficient to understand these means at my disposal. Before getting into that, I suppose it would be proper to tell part of the story first. Let's see, I had returned to my home in Themyscira to rest and to relax. Perhaps, if I was lucky, find a date and attend a show. As I had walked through the door, to my surprise, my sister, Nemesis, had been waiting for me. She had not been alone. Accompanying her was God Eros. "Good evening, Nemesis," I said. I greeted her with a kiss on the cheeks. "Good evening, Eros," I said. I greeted him with a kiss on the cheeks. Nemesis smiled and replied, "Good evening, my dear sister. Might I have a word with you, alone?" She had seemed in such earnest that I agreed to her wishes. "Keep yourself entertained, Eros. We will go into the kitchen and talk," I said. "Thank you, Themis," Eros said. He stood up and bowed to me. At first, I thought his behavior had been strange, but I did not think much about it. My sister and I went into the next room. Once we were in the kitchen, I offered to make my sister some coffee. "Can I offer you some coffee, Nemesis?" I said. "Yes, I would like some coffee." "Thank you," she said. "I will make the coffee, and you can explain to me what you came here to say," I said. "Okay," she replied. As Nemesis made herself comfortable at the kitchen table, I had begun to heat up the water to make the coffee. As I had stated before, the need for the exposition of my internal powers is necessary at this point. My sister and I are what the immortals refer to as primordial gods. Primordial gods are the entities that control basic forces of the multiverse. Why were we chosen to be the custodians of cosmic forces in nature? Only the Creator knows. In my case, my primordial power is to govern over divine justice, or what the Hellenians, the Greeks, refer to as that which is put in place. My sister's primordial power is to govern over divine retribution, or what the Hellenians refer to as to give what is due. In our case, we both have governed over these forces for 13 billion years. By mortal standards, God Eros is another primordial god, and he governs over the force of desire or future dreams. His mother, goddess Aphrodite, she governs over how people relate to each other. In pagan terms, she governs over the spirit of life over the cross of matter. Complement to goddess Aphrodite, God Ares governs over the individual's place in the universe. In pagan terms, he governs over the cross of matter over the spirit of life. How does this relate to the story? You see, as I have been talking to my sister, Nemesis, mental images of the future have streamed through my mind. The way this works for me is my mind develops several streams at one time. Each stream is a possible future. This is like how Athanata's truth vision works, but her power streams events that have already occurred in space and in time. My future vision or clairvoyance are not absolute certainties. They are at best probabilities. As I have stated, mental images of two possible futures streamed through my mind. What future will come? This will not be by my will alone. As goddess of nature, our wills are not our own. This is where we are different from mortals and meta-humans. God Zeus gave mortals free will when he made a deal with Titan Prometheus, which is one of the reasons why they die in about 100 years. For the rest of us immortals, we have a limited will. Our powers are governed by individual gods, but they affect each of us in a symphony. So, before my sister had gone about her desire to help Eros and I enjoy intercourse together, I had been made aware of this probable future. My reasons for not dismissing my sister's plan outright, I must explain after the entire story plays out. I suppose that deep down inside, I knew that this would be fun. After some time, the water was heated up and the coffee started brewing in the carafe. "Do go on, Nemesis. Why are you and Eros here?" I asked. "Well, dear sister, I had been walking in the woods by the house when I ran into Eros sitting at the overlook by our house. I made some inquiries, and he told me that he had fallen in love with you," she said. I smiled and giggled like a teenager. "I am not sure why I did." "Me? Why would Eros fall in love with me?" I asked. "Dear sister, I know you have a big heart, but you take for granted just how powerful you and those mesmerizing blue eyes are," she said. "Go on, I said, Eros told me that you and he had gone to a party some time ago, and that you two had danced and had talked together, and sometime after that, he developed a teenage crush on you. He told me that he had felt silly about the whole affair. He said that Psyche told him to follow his heart. She said, and that is when you told him the whole thing about unlike terms and age. I said, yes. She said, she had looked in my eyes. Was I wrong, dear sister? She asked. No, you were not wrong. I know that your heart was in the right place. I said, so, what do I do now, Nemesis? I asked. I am sure that after 13 billion years, you know how the game works, Themis. She said, not that I don't know the answer, dear sister, but let me guess. A show, a dinner, and then he feeds me full of chocolate. Then I get high and he pumps me full of his godhood. I said jokingly, I think you covered all the bases, dear sister. But, just don't block home plate. Men these days just are not into the cock blocking. She said, always the voice of reality, Nemesis. I said jokingly. I had paused for the moment and thought about Athanata. I know that look, Themis. You are concerned that your affair with Eros will interfere with your work with Athanata. Nemesis said, I am concerned, dear sister. She is on an important assignment for Athena right now. She must find a subject named Solene Kyle and determine if she can be saved. I said, you and she are always working for Athena. I think Athena forgets that she, Athena, works for you, dear sister. Nemesis said, well, to be fair, Athanata works for all of us. The poor girl always having to let people rape her and subject her to such cruelty. She had been given all that power and all that responsibility, yet, her will is not her own either. It saddens me to witness all the true nature that Athanata must endure. But, I guess that intercourse is the only true way that people reveal themselves. I said, Nemesis had walked behind me and gave me a hug. Yes, but even Athanata is letting her man, Steve, lay into her tonight, dear sister. How she loves that mortal, she said. I smiled. Do not misunderstand me, Themis. The work you do is important for the cosmos, but even a goddess needs to get laid occasionally, she said. I chuckled. And besides, if she should call on you, I can take your place. You do remember that the lasso of truth binds both of us to Athanata. You determine who she will save, and I determine who she will slay, dear sister, she said. I know, I said. I paused for a moment. Perhaps, we should go talk with Eros. The poor guy has been waiting patiently for us in the other room. Maybe if he plays us right, we can get him to have sex with the both of us. I said jokingly. Nemesis laughed. It has been some time since we tagged team a fellow god. I guess that is one of the benefits of being a twin, Nemesis said joking back. Prior to walking out to the living room, I had put together a tray with some cheese, crackers, and coffee. Nemesis led the way out to the living room where we both had joined Eros. I trust that you are comfortable, Eros, I said. He stood up. Yes, Themis, I am very comfortable, he said smiling. Well, look at the time. I am going to go for a walk and leave you two to talk together, Nemesis said. I smiled and waved goodbye to Nemesis as she left the house. Eros and I sat on the sofa together. Nemesis has told me that you have fallen in love with me, Eros, I said. He looked away bashfully. I smiled. It is okay, Eros. Knowing that fact does not bother me, I said. He turned back to look at me. Thank you, Themis. Moments like these can be full of anxiety for a fellow, you know, he said. I took his hands into my hands. It is okay, Eros. You can talk to me, I said. Where should I begin? My heart is racing 1,000 times a minute. You would think the god of desire and love would be quite calm at a time like this, he said. It is okay, Eros. Just take it one step at a time, I said. He took my hands into his hands. For some time now, Themis, I have had you on my mind. I know that a mental obsession does not give me any reason or right to bother you with such nonsense, but I feel that talking with you about it would be the best course of action for me, he said. I guess that is better than drugging the girl and tricking her into bed, I said jokingly. He chuckled. Yes, Nemesis said that was a possible course of action, but the thought of doing that to you pains my heart, Themis. I don't want to hurt you or dupe you into liking me, he said. His words had caused me to become teary-eyed. Now look, I made you cry, he said sadly. No, oh no, Eros, as I wiped my eyes, these are good tears. They mean that I care for you too, I said. I smiled. The only question now is, do we go with the feeling or do we not go with the feeling, I said. He had looked concerned. Well, Themis, what are your feelings now? He asked. I smiled. To be honest, Eros, my feelings are not telling me no, if you get my meaning, I said. He had seemed to find joy in my answer, and stood up. Well, Miss Themis, would you like to go to a dance with me tonight? He asked. I smiled and laughed. Sure, I would love to go to a dance with you, Mr. Eros, I said. What is the theme? I asked. I think it is 19th century night tonight, he said. You mean with those tight corsets and large dresses? I asked. Yes, you would look so attractive in that outfit, Themis, he said. And, are you implying that I am not attractive now, Eros? I said jokingly. This had seemed to confuse him and send his anxiety into overdrive. I didn't offend you, Miss Themis, did I? He asked. I smiled. No, you didn't offend me, Eros. I was just trying to get into the spirit. It is 1943 and mortal women have the right to vote now, I said. To help give Eros some confidence, I had given him a kiss on the cheeks. And, in return, he had kissed my hand. For the time being, we both parted our ways so that he could go get ready for the dance, and I could go get ready for the dance. Diana's Journal, Thursday, December 16, 1943, 6 o'clock in the morning. The morning had seemed to come early, today. My body was still sore from my encounter with Solomon Grundy, Cyrus Gold, from yesterday morning. Quickly, I changed into my workout gear and put on my running shoes. I had gone out of my way not to disturb Steve, as he slept in our bed. I had turned on the radio while I had been in the process of changing my clothes. The radio man had reported that the temperature in Gotham County would be a high of 30 degrees Fahrenheit F, and a low of 14 degrees Fahrenheit. With my clothes and shoes properly placed on my body, quietly, I worked my way out to the patio and waited for the others. I used the moment to stretch out my body. It may seem odd to the mortals that may read this journal to learn that immortals need to stretch their bodies out before exercise, but we do have to give our bodies a proper stretch. It is interesting how mortals imply immortality as a reason to be lazy and undisciplined. However, immortality requires more discipline and more labor to function in the society. Having read the contemporary fiction of the 1940s, I had gotten the sense that mortals believe that the immortals are just sitting around plotting murder and mayhem, when the opposite is the better description. Etta was the first to join me outside on the patio. Good morning, Diana, she said. She gave me a hug. Good morning, Etta, I said. I had hugged her back. My goodness, it is cold this morning, Diana, Etta claimed. She had shivered for a while as her body had acclimated to the outside temperature. I had not really noticed, Etta, I said. Etta had smiled at me. Oh, now, you are just rubbing in your immortality, Diana, she said jokingly. I laughed. Etta looked me over with an eye that detected something out of place. Are you still sore from yesterday, Diana? She asked. Yes, my lower back and my sexual organs are all still sore from being stretched to their extremes, I said. She seemed concerned. Doesn't your body heal by regenerating rapidly? She asked. It does, Etta, but my spiritual mass heals independently from my physical mass while in my physical plane body, I said. Spiritual mass? She asked. I guess this requires some explanation. See, Etta, all of us, mortal, meta-humans, and immortals have a spiritual mass and a physical mass. Our soul connects the two parts together. When we transform into our earthly bodies, we immortals consciously reduce our size to mortal standards. If we did not do this, we would affect the motion of the planet. I said, I see, that is a very interesting aspect of immortality that I did not know, Diana, Etta said. As I had completed my exposition, Hippolyta and Elizabeth had arrived out on the patio. The two women seemed to be in a calm and in a relaxed manner. Elizabeth, like Etta, had been dressed in a gray sweatsuit, which consisted of a one-piece top sweatshirt and a one-piece bottom sweatpant. Hippolyta was dressed in a pair of shorts and a t-shirt. Good morning, Mother, I said. I gave my mother a hug. Good morning, Elizabeth, I said. I gave Elizabeth a hug. Good morning, Diana, the two women said while hugging me back. Etta had greeted each of the women with a warm hug and a wonderful smile. Good morning, Elizabeth. Good morning, Hippolyta. Hippolyta and Elizabeth gave Etta a warm hug. You seem well rested, Hippolyta, Etta said. I did get a good night's sleep, Etta, Hippolyta said. I know, I felt you last night, Mother, I said. Mother had smiled. Well, at first, I was not really in the mood, but Cyrus managed to push all the right buttons, and I could not find the will to stop. She said, speaking of wills, don't you have a writing lesson today, Etta? I asked. Etta smiled. I sure do. Why don't you come with me, Elizabeth? Etta asked. Oh, I am not sure if I should, Elizabeth said. Etta smiled. Please come, Elizabeth. I am sure Miles would not mind, Etta said. Elizabeth smiled and thought to herself for a moment. Can I take a rain check, Etta? She asked. Etta jokingly made a sad face. You're trying to guilt trip me, aren't you, Etta? Elizabeth said. Is it working? Etta asked. No, but I have to meet with some officials to review the final arrangements for the Wayne Foundation annual Christmas ball, she said. The revelation of the ball made all our ears perk up. A ball? Hippolyta asked. Yes, the Wayne Foundation hosts a charity ball every Christmas to raise money for the children of Gotham City's many orphanages. With the war, the need for donations is high, Elizabeth said. Is there a way for us to help? I asked. Well, if it is not an inconvenience, perhaps Wonder Woman would like to appear at the ball. I am sure the children would like that, Elizabeth said. I smiled. I can arrange that, Elizabeth. How about 5 Wonder Women? I asked. Elizabeth smiled. That would be fabulous, Diana, she said. As Elizabeth and Hippolyta completed their stretches, we all made our way around the perimeter of the driveway of Wayne Manor. The whole event had been about a half an hour for the jog and 15 minutes doing push-ups, sit-ups, and pull-ups. After an hour, our exercise session was over. We had gone our separate ways back to our rooms to shower, change, and get ready for breakfast. Myself, I had returned to the room. Steve had awakened already and had been showering. I decided to rip off my clothes and join him.
Steve Trevor's Journal, Thursday, December 16, 1943. 45 minutes after 6 o'clock in the morning for me, the morning had come uneventfully. As I did not have anywhere to be today, I had planned to sleep in a little later than my normal routine. But my daily habits had gotten the better of me, which had made it difficult to stay asleep. So I had decided to get out of the bed and grab a shower. While I was well into my shower, Diana had come into the room to join me. I could tell by the way that she had walked into the room that she still had been sore from the battle with Solomon Grundy from the other night. I had reached out to examine her back muscles to get a sense of how tender the muscles had become. You are still sore from the night before, Diana, he asked. She smiled. In the time that Diana and I have been in a relationship and since the time we had met at Theme is Scare Awe, I have come to learn Diana's subtle behaviors. Brave face and best face. Although I do understand that her duty as a goddess of justice will place her at the mercy of the foes she is charged to help by the goddess Athena, there is a deep part of my spirit that does not enjoy it. My caring for Diana goes far deeper than our sexual behaviors. I could tell in my feelings that Diana was not well. Since her battle with Solomon Grundy, she had seemed quieter and at times, she had seemed distant. Yes, my lower back muscles feel like a big weight has been chained to them, she said. She had placed her hands up along her lower back muscles to indicate where she was stiff and sore. I had used my hands to knead her back muscles with the hot water along with her lower spine. How does that feel? I asked. She closed her eyes as my hands pressed into her lower back muscles. That feels good, Steve. Don't stop, she said. Perhaps, we should take a few days off for your back muscles to heal, I said. She smiled. I will be okay, Steve. Besides, we are going to the Wayne Foundation annual Christmas ball, she said. I see. I have never really been to a ball, I said. It will be fun. I told Elizabeth that I will go as Wonder Woman for the children. She thinks that it will help raise money for the local charities. Hippolyta and my sisters will be going too, she said. I think that is a wonderful idea, Diana, I said, pressing my hands into her lower back. We had spent the rest of the time cleaning each other's back and washing off. A short time later, we were dressed and had made our way downstairs to eat breakfast. Manfred had given me a message from Colonel Darnell with a call back number. As it must be urgent, I found a nearby telephone in the study to call the colonel. After a few rings, he had picked up the phone. Good, Steve. I had submitted my report to General Blankenship. I know that Diana and you are on leave, but I was wondering if you two would meet with General Blankenship and me today. He said, of course, Colonel, we will be there today. What time do you want to schedule our appointment? I asked. Let's make it for noon, Steve. He said, yes, noon it is. I will relay the news to Petty Officer Prince. I said, okay, Steve, bye. He said as he had hung up the telephone. Bye, Colonel, I said as I had hung up the telephone. I had made my way back to the dining room where Manfred had laid out the breakfast buffet. All the others had already made their way to the room and had begun their breakfast. Diana, we will be having lunch with Colonel Darnell and General Blankenship at the War Department today, I said. Of course, Steve, she said. As Diana and I had sat down at the table to eat our breakfast, Hippolyta turned her attention to Donna and Drusilla. And, how are you two getting along this morning? Hippolyta asked. The two women smiled. I think that we are settled in, Mother, Donna said. Good, if you two do not mind, Elizabeth is preparing for a charity ball this week. I need you two to work with her and help her in any way you can, Hippolyta said. She paused for a moment to collect her thoughts. Also, I would like for you two to work out some site plans and engineering plans for the real estate that we are purchasing from Elizabeth. Alan will be able to assist you with any local zoning laws, Hippolyta said. Of course, Mother. We will get started on that at once, Drusilla said. If it is not too much trouble, may I assist the two ladies? I was an attorney for the county. I think a project of this kind would help me to acclimate myself to the current laws. Of course, Cyrus. We would be happy to have your assistance, Donna said. I will be attending a horse riding lesson at the Wayne Stables this morning. I cannot say if I will be free this afternoon, Etta said. She smiled to herself as perverted thoughts went through her mind. Etta, we all who could read telepathy said together. Man, I wish that I had telepathy, Silas said. Patrick smiled. You and me both, Silas, Patrick said. I had to chuckle as I didn't need telepathy to know what Etta had thought. Diana smiled. I have two friends stopping by this morning. They had heard that I was recovering from my altercation with Solomon Grundy. I sent them a letter to meet me at Wayne Manor this morning, Alan said. You seem distant, Diana. Are you feeling okay? Hippolyta asked. Diana smiled. I am okay, Mother. I am still sore from the other night, Diana said. Hippolyta looked concerned. Oh, perhaps, you should spend some time in the medical bath, Hippolyta suggested. Maybe later, after we get back from our appointment, Diana said. Diana smiled. Will you be investigating the whereabouts of Margaret Shaw, Mother? Diana asked. Yes, I will have to pay a visit with Lord Hades to acquire some information, Hippolyta said. Diana, Donna, and Drusilla sighed at the mention of Lord Hades. Is there something wrong about Lord Hades? Elizabeth asked. Hippolyta smiled. Well, Lord Hades is very pleasant. It is just he always expects his payments up front, and he and his wife, Persephone, are always throwing these wild parties, Hippolyta said. I feel sore all over just thinking about it, Mother, Drusilla said. I know, Hippolyta said. The rest of the morning had been rather peaceful as all of us went about with our breakfast. Once completed, all of us went our separate ways for the morning. Diana and I had returned to our room to get ready for our appointment at noon. Letter to Helmut Stryker, December 17, 1943, 9 o'clock in the morning. Colonel, I have received your letter via the secure radio transmission. After reading your field report on the Solomon Grundy matter, I concur with your analysis of the situation. High Command has advised me to refer you to a local expert in the occult science in your area. He is Dr. Edgar Sisko, a renowned scientist in his field of study. He will meet with you today at your field office at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, Eastern Standard Time. General, Journal of Edgar Sisko, December 17, 1943, 9 o'clock in the morning. This morning, I had received a message from my assistant to visit a local physicist, Dr. Helmut Stryker. The letter was not specific on details. It only suggested that I should meet with the doctor on an urgent matter that called for my expertise in the occult sciences. Normally, I would turn down such an invitation as I prefer to work alone, but they offered to pay me for my services any amount I wanted. As my research requires adequate funding from private donors, the offer seemed to warrant an investigation. I had used my telepathy to gain insight into the matter. All knowledge is contained in the ether of the universe. My initial scan with my telepathy revealed to me that Dr. Stryker is a scientist for the Nazi Party of Germany. He had been sent here in the 1930s before the war had started. Here he laid in wait for the rise of war. He had stayed hidden from the mass public's eye and lived as a lonely college professor. Most people had known him as Stephen George Hamilton, a faculty member at Georgetown University. As I had further probed his mind, I had come to learn that he had been involved in a matter in Gotham County, Maryland the other night that forced him to lie low for some time. The letter stated that a car would come around to my laboratory at 10 o'clock in the morning. Then, the car would deliver me to the meeting site. The letter stated that secrecy was the utmost important matter. My telepathy did not reveal anything foul, so I decided to entertain the doctor's meeting.
Etta Candy's Journal, December 17, 1943, 10 o'clock in the morning. I saw Steve and Diana off when they left for Washington, D.C. in Diana's car. The rest of us had stayed at the manor for the rest of the morning. Elizabeth had spent the morning making several phone calls to her event planners for the Wayne Foundation Ball. Alan went with her to take care of the press releases for the added event for Wonder Woman to be at the ball. Donna, Drusilla, and Cyrus were knee-deep into planning out the early stages of their engineering plan to renovate the Brownstone Estate. Myself, I used the time to head out to the stables for my horse riding lessons. I had left word with Manfred as to where I would be going in the event someone needed to get hold of me. As before, it had been a short walk to the stables that were located on the property. And like the day before, I had let my nose lead me to the stables. 15 minutes after 10 o'clock, as I had approached the stables where the horses were housed, I saw Miles Evan directing some of the other stable handlers to their morning tasks. All the men had seemed to be in good spirits as they all were laughing and smiling when I walked up to them. "Good morning, Miss Candy," Miles said. "Thank you and good morning to all of you," I replied. "Are you ready to start your riding lessons?" he asked. "Yes, I am ready to start," I answered. He smiled. "Good. John, here is going to spend the first hour going over basic safety procedures that you need to learn to prevent any unnecessary accidents." "Okay, I am sure my pride will be one of those accidents," I said. For the next hour, I sat there listening to the guys demonstrate the practical ways to avoid injuries when riding the horses. Hippolyta's Journal, December 17, 1943, 11 o'clock in the morning. After breakfast, I had gone to prepare my things for my trek to the underworld. Since most of my artifacts were clothes and shoes, it did not take me long to get them back into the ship. One of the genoids helped me ferry my belongings over to the ship. As we were moving back and forth, Donna had approached me. She had seemed to be concerned for my well-being. "Yes, Donna?" I asked. "Mother, I cannot help to be concerned about this trip you are planning. Perhaps it would be prudent for one of us to accompany you today?" I smiled. "I know, Donna, but I feel that for this part of my journey, as I am sorting out the details, it is best that I do it alone. Besides, Hades will be celebrating the festival for Apollo and the return of Persephone to the underworld. I rather I entertain a bunch of horny demons and deities myself. If we went as a mother and daughter duo, they would make us do all kinds of embarrassing sexual rituals for their entertainment," I said. Donna smiled. "All in a day's work for an Amazon mother," she said with confidence. I chuckled. "I should be back in time for the ball. I will leave it to you to prepare my dress for the evening," I said. "Of course, Mother." "Donna, look after your sister, Athanata. She is putting up a brave face, but I know that she had been severely weakened from the encounter with Solomon Grundy," I said in a soft voice. Donna hugged my body warmly and said, "I will, Mother. Goodbye." As we said our goodbyes next to the ship, and the droids had completed the loading up of my things into the cargo holds, I ordered the genoids to depart from Gotham County and to set course for the underworld phase.
Alan Scott's Journal, December 17, 1943, 11 o'clock in the morning. I had been on the telephone talking to my secretary about arranging a press release for the evening newspaper and evening radio news report. Although I am not the head editor for the Gotham Gazette, our radio office resides within the same building as the newspaper office. As I wanted to be sure to get the maximum amount of exposure for the ball to let the mass public audience know that Wonder Woman would be attending the Wayne Foundation annual Christmas ball. "Yes, I want the release to head out as soon as possible," I said. "Of course, Alan, I will see to it personally," she replied. "Thank you, Sarah, I do appreciate your hard work and dedication to the job," I said. After that, I had hung up the telephone. Manfred had walked up to me with a message. "Master Scott," he asked. "Please, Manfred, call me Alan," I said. "Of course, Master Alan. There are two gentlemen here to see you, Master Garrick and Master Jones. I have taken the liberty of escorting them to the living room," he said. I smiled. "Thank you, Manfred. I will see to them," I said. Manfred left the room as I headed over to the living room, which was a short distance from the study. As I had walked into the room, there were Jay Garrick and John Jones. Jay Garrick was a tall man at 5 feet and 8 inches. He had short blonde hair and was a thin athletic build. He was not skinny, but he was not as muscular as Steve Trevor had been. John Jones was a tall man at 6 feet and 3 inches. He had dark hair and dark skin. His build was muscular and athletic. Personally, I would describe him as a fine specimen of manhood. I smiled as I approached the two metahumans. "Good morning, Jay," I said as I had shaken his hand. He smiled and had returned the handshake. "Good morning, Alan," Jay said. "Good morning, John," I said as I had shaken his hand. He smiled and had returned the handshake. "This is quite a step up from the usual dives we have found you in, Alan," John said jokingly. We all laughed. "I am moving up in the world," I said. "The Waynes are quite a step up for your social network, Alan," Jay said. "Please have a seat. I wanted to brief you on what has happened in the last few days. It is lengthy, but if you bear with me, then you will understand all." The two men sat down on a nearby couch. "This verbal explanation is more for Jay's benefit, as I know John is a telepath," I said. I had taken out a copy of the manuscript that narrated the tale from the last few days that Diana and Hippolyta had provided for me. I gave one copy to Jay and one copy to John. John looked over the manuscript with a keen eye. "This is quite a bit to read, Alan," John said. "I know. Diana and Hippolyta journal in detail about their adventures and have recorded them in these journals in a wonderful epistolary narration. The events from the last few days will give you both great insight and a great understanding of what we have endured. The story requires about 18 hours to read, but I will give you the condensed version for now until you have time to read the entire text," I said. Jay Garrick had wasted no time to show off his meta-human powers of speed. "Done. It was a fascinating read," he said while smiling. John looked at Jay astonished, but knew it would take him more time to read the manuscript. "Show off. I will require more time to read the journals, Alan," John said. "Allow me, Alan." Jay stood up to retell the story to John. "Short version of the story is Diana is Wonder Woman. Her mother and the others beat down a big scary dude in Gotham City yesterday morning. He raped Diana and she absorbed his life essence with her empathic abilities, which restored him back to who he was when he died in 1894. Also, the ladies are super horny, which seems to be one of their superpowers except for Etta Candy. She is out getting riding lessons from a stud horse trainer, currently," Jay said. "Did I get all the facts?" Jay asked. I smiled. "I think that you have covered most of it except for the part where yours truly had been bushwhacked by Solomon Grundy," I said. "I thought I had taught you to duck, Alan," John said jokingly. I smiled. "From what I remember of the event, I saw a big bright light and my body went numb. Luckily, Etta and Hippolyta were able to drag my body back to the car," I said. The two men's demeanor had changed to one of concern for my health. "The journal reported that all your bones were shattered. How are you walking around today?" Jay asked with concern. "Diana and Hippolyta have advanced medical equipment aboard their ships. They had arranged the triage, which was used to treat my medical trauma," I said. John Jones smiled. "What is amusing you, John?" I asked. "I am familiar with Diana and Hippolyta Autry Reyeres, although, many years ago, Diana went by another name," John said. "Often, I forget that you have lived a very long time, John," I said. He put his hand on my shoulder. "My memory of the Queen and the Princess are good ones. In a time where I thought my life was lost, they were both a ray of light for me," he said. "Speaking of light, Alan, you said your ring was destroyed in the melee with Solomon Grundy," Jay said. "Yes, I will need to make repairs the unit," I replied. As I had begun my explanation, Drusilla and Donna had entered the room. All three of our eyes had shifted their focus to the two lovely women. As with Hippolyta and Diana, the two Amazon women had a mesmerizing aura about them. Their eyes were very soft and warm when gazed at. "Jay Garrick and John Jones, I like for you to meet Donna and Drusilla." John had kissed the hands of the two women. The two women had been amused by John's charm. Drusilla smiled. "So formal, John," she said. Donna smiled. "Are all the men in Gotham County so pleasant?" she asked. Jay Garrick smiled. "I am just a simple country boy. I am not schooled in such manners or pleasantry," he said jokingly. Drusilla laughed. "What unit do you need to be repaired, Alan?" Drusilla asked. "My power ring had been damaged in the melee with Solomon Grundy the day before, and I had not had the time to repair the unit," I said while showing her the hardware. Donna looked at the power ring with interest. Diana left her ship here and it has the forge that is required to heat the alloys in this jewelry. We just need to construct a new mold to set the ring," she explained. Drusilla looked at the ring with interest. Diana and Steve will not be back until later this afternoon. We can use the time to repair your ring if you all did not have other plans. She stated, I can speak for the three of us. I think that is a wonderful idea. Plus, we can eat lunch here at the manor while we wait for Diana and Steve to get back. I said, did you two ladies have any other tasks you needed to complete this morning? I asked. Drusilla smiled, not really. We were drawing up some site plans and engineering plans for the real estate Hippolyta are buying from Elizabeth. We were going to go into town later today to get some information from the county records office. She said, we had thought to wait to see if Diana and Steve would come back before committing to that plan. Maybe they would want to go out later this afternoon as a group. Donna said, Jay smiled, might I make a suggestion, ladies? He asked. We all waited with curiosity. Let's wait for the two to get back and repair Alan's ring. And once grouped up we can go to my place in town, he suggested. Donna smiled. What kind of place is this? She asked. A real dump, John Jones said jokingly. All kidding aside, I run a small establishment here in town called No Man's Land, he explained. Drusilla smiled. An interesting name. I grew up in a no man's land, she said jokingly. I laughed. Well, nothing like theme is scare ah. No man's land is a place where meta-humans can hang out at without fear of reprisal, I said. Donna smiled. That sounds interesting. Shall we proceed to the ship and make the repairs on your ring then? She asked. At her suggestion, we all had departed the room and had made our way to the ship.
Diana's Journal, December 17, 1943, 11 o'clock in the morning. As I am recalling the events in this journal for this particular time, some time has passed. As the time had been closer to the event, I had made some notes. At the time, I had been feeling tired and lethargic from the battle with Solomon Grundy. After several weeks of rest, I have decided to commit the facts of this tale to the pages of this journal now. I remembered that I had made a journal entry earlier in the morning before breakfast. However, as Steve and I got into the car and made our trek to the War Department in Washington, D.C., I must have dozed off. If it had not been for my truth vision, I would have no memory of the time. Wayne Manor had been located in a section of Gotham County that had been known as Spook Hill. By car, it would be a journey of around 1 hour and 30 minutes. Steve had let me sleep on our journey into town. I had awakened as we approached the outskirts of the district. As my conscious mind regained awareness, I sat up and had looked around. Steven, you let me doze off? I asked. Yes, Diana. You had seemed so at peace with yourself. I did not want to disturb the moment, he said. I felt a warm pressure in my heart. Thank you, Steve. You take such good care of me, I said. He smiled. I have to yeoman prince. It would take weeks to replace you as a secretary, he said jokingly. I smiled. I didn't mess up my makeup, did I? I asked. He looked me over with a detailed eye. I do not think that is even possible, Diana, he claimed. How long was I asleep? I asked. I would say about an hour, he said. I paused to collect my thoughts. I feel so tired, Steve. I have not felt this tired in centuries. I must have expended more mana than I had originally thought, I said. Steve looked over towards me with concern. Is there a way to recharge your mana outside of sleep? He asked. I smiled. Well, I do not want to seem slutty, Steve, but sexual intercourse is one method, I said. Steve smiled. Wait, you're not kidding, are you? He asked. I smiled. No, as a celestial immortal, we are connected to the environment. We draw energy from the spirits around us. Natural sexual intercourse refuels our mana. Likewise, artificial intercourse draws energy away from us, I said. In your battle with Solomon Grundy, it was a natural sexual intercourse, Steve said. He thought for a moment. Wouldn't he have restored your energy? He asked. I theorize that because he was undead and part plant, the intercourse was artificial, and if I recall correctly, he had drained my energy unnaturally with some kind of bioenergy feed, I said. Is there anything that I can do to help you? He asked. Well, if you see me dozing off with the general around, give me a gentle nudge, I said jokingly. He smiled. Time update. Some time had gone by as we made our way to the building of the War Department. We had to park our car away from the compound. The War Department had been located in a vast complex along the National Mall along Constitution Avenue. The facility had been built in 1918, and it had been greatly expanded in the 1930s. The new War Department building is currently being constructed across the Potomac River, in Arlington, Virginia, our office has not been scheduled to move into our new occupancy at the new location until after January 1, 1944. I should point out that some of our counterparts in the War Department were slowly being moved into the new Pentagon-shaped building as time goes on. With the construction of the new building and other construction projects going on in the district, the parking space at the munitions building had been at a premium. The parking fees for downtown Washington, D.C. were not cheap in 1943. It cost us 20 cents a day to park our car near our work site. After making our way past several security checkpoints, we made it into the building that housed our department. Despite Steve's joking earlier about a secretary, his main secretary had been removed when she had been discovered to be secretly feeding intelligence reports to Nazi spies in November. He had not had her replaced yet. As we had made our way into the work center, we ran into Colonel Darnell. "Good morning, Colonel," Steve said. "Good morning, Major Trevor and Yeoman Prince. Is there anything I can get for you, Colonel?" I asked. He smiled. "See to it that the main conference room is ready to go for the general when he arrives," Darnell asked. "Aye, sir. I will have the room and equipment prepped for the general," I replied. As it was a half hour before noon, I knew that we had some time to prepare for the meeting. I took some time to arrange the chairs and dust off the furniture. I prepped the slide projector in the event the general wished to use the device. Then, I went over to the restaurant across the street to get some food. Since it was a lunch, I felt that a light meal of salad and sandwiches were in order. The restaurant had a delicatessen, so I ordered some sliced ham, sliced turkey, and sliced chicken. Also, I grabbed some beef, salami, and pastrami to add as a variety of the other meats. I ordered some sliced cheese, provolone, cheddar, and American sliced cheese. I had purchased a small container of Miracle Whip and Heinz ketchup, and I purchased several bottles of soda cola. With the order completed, I traveled back to the office by foot carrying the food and drinks. Once I had made it back to the work center, I had laid out the food in a buffet-style arrangement on the table that sat along one of the walls in the conference room. As I had completed the arrangement, Steve had walked into the room along with Colonel Darnell and General Blankenship. 12 o'clock in the afternoon. "Diana, you did a wonderful job in setting up that table spread for lunch on short notice," Steve said. I smiled. "Thank you, Major Trevor. It was my pleasure to make the meeting as enjoyable as possible," I said. "General Blankenship's description here." "This is an excellent spread of cold cuts, Yeoman Prince," Blankenship said. He smiled. "I would like to keep this meeting informal if that is okay with everyone. I understand that you two have been out in the field with the Solomon Grundy incident. Before we get started, please, everyone take the time to get comfortable and enjoy the wonderful food Yeoman Prince has arranged," Blankenship said. I smiled. "Thank you, General Blankenship," I said. All four of us took some time to get our plates with sandwiches and drinks arranged. Then, we sat around the conference table. The general started the meeting as we all ate the food. "Steve, I have read your field report since our last meeting about the Solomon Grundy matter. Quite an extraordinary event. The Nazi intelligence agents in the area using a metahuman to attack our shipping lines inside the continental United States has brought great concerns to the President and the Joint Chiefs of Staff. They, in turn, have directed the Office of Strategic Services to retool the Anonymous Ranger Group of the United States into the Advanced Research Group Uniting Superhumans, or ARGUS," Blankenship said. He continued, "Major General William J. Donovan asked me personally to head up the department. I want to bring Colonel Darnell's office into that department, effective immediately," he stated. "This is quite an honor, General Blankenship," Colonel Darnell stated. "Yes, my compliments, General," Major Trevor said. I smiled. Unknown to Steve and the others, Hippolyta had been part of the old Argus service during the American Revolutionary War. Back then, it had been known as the Armed Revolutionaries Governing Under Secrecy. Myself, I had lived in France during that time period. She had written quite extensively about the organization as she had journeyed throughout the U.S. Western territories in the 19th century. Formally, Hippolyta had been appointed by the U.S. Marshal Office by President George Washington. Although this job had been done in secrecy because the greater population of Americans did not know that metahumans existed. Not to give the impression that no one knew of metahumans, it had not been widely reported in government documents and public news reports. Although it had been written as folklore and fiction in some contemporary literature. I add this last section to give any reader of this text a sense of my state of mind as the general laid out his responsibilities before us. My truth vision had been telling me that the general wanted to formally know if Diana Prince and Wonder Woman were one in the same. I could see in his mind with my telepathy, and I could feel in his heart with my empathy that his plan had been, if he could get one, Steve, then he could recruit the other, me, into his organization. For a short time, I had struggled with revealing the truth to the general and the colonel. Before the next events had taken place, Goddess Athena had appeared to me. She arranged for us to talk in a pocket dimension, or a place that exists outside of the human ninth realm. I had kneeled before the goddess. "Goddess Athena, how may I serve you?" I asked. Goddess Athena smiled. "Thank you, Diana. Please sit. There is much to discuss," she said. "Yes, I will listen," I said. "You must reveal yourself to the general and the colonel to facilitate your relationship with Stephen Trevor," she said. "But, what of the law of non-interference?" I asked. "With this great war in front of us, the humans have aligned themselves with several deities. You must maintain your relationship with the Major to help him complete his work with the General." Athena paused. "The humans stand at a pivotal point in their future. One path will lead to tyranny, and the other path will lead to justice," she said. I reflected for a moment. "What of Selene Kyle?" "My work with her is not completed," I stated. Athena gazed into my eyes with her soft gray eyes. "The path you are on will intersect with Selene Kyle. In time, she will seek you out. But, Athenata, do not act out of haste. The decisions that you make in these two destinies will have far-reaching effect on other people." "Yes, my goddess, will be done," I said. With that, Goddess Athena had raised her arms and folded out of the realm. I had been returned to my body. For the others in the room, no time had passed. The president had shown great concern that the Nazi were so close to discovering the work going on at the Clinton Engineering Works in Tennessee. "We need to know what the Nazi know about the facilities and any other intel we can acquire," Blankenship stated. "Yes, General, the Major and the yeoman have been in the field gathering intel for us on that subject," Darnell stated. The general turned and gazed at me with a keen eye for observation. "Yes, the president has extended his gratitude to you two and Wonder Woman for your ability to collect detailed data on the subject matter," Blankenship said. "I am concerned, General, that if our office is going to be absorbed into your agency, that we may lose momentum on the case. We are not slated to move over to the new War Department building in Arlington until next year," Steve said. The general paused. "I too am deeply concerned that we will lose momentum and give our enemy time to gather their strength," Blankenship stated. The colonel stood up. "If I may, I think that I can handle any logistical concerns of integrating our office with the general's office. That shouldn't affect the field work that you two are doing. I am concerned that if I am out of the office, then the colonel will not have ample help with arranging the office projects. I am his secretary and not Major Trevor's secretary," I stated. "That is not going to be a problem, Yeoman Prince. Under the restructuring of the office, Steve is going to be promoted to the rank of colonel to head up the field assignments for Argus. You will be assigned to his staff, and Colonel Darnell will run the research and development office for Argus," the general said. Steve looked astonished. "Thank you, General and Colonel, for your confidence in me. I will not let you down," Steve said. I had walked over to pour myself a new cup of soda cola. "Now, the last detail we need to satisfy with the president is the matter of Wonder Woman," Blankenship stated. My ears perked up. Steve listened to the general's next words with concern. "Wonder Woman? Why is the president concerned with Wonder Woman?" Steve asked. "Well, after some research into past Argus operations conducted in the American Revolutionary War, I came across some detailed field reports that I found fascinating, Major," Blankenship said. The general had looked around the room as everyone sat quietly listening to his words. He pulled out a briefcase which contained some old parchment papers that were stamped with the seal of the President of the United States, George Washington. "If you will look closely at these documents, Major, you will see that they are signed by a field agent named Hippolyta Autrera Ares. She continued to file reports to Argus until the late 19th century or the year 1895. The general stood up to get some soda cola and smiled while looking my way. "Of course, I had maintained a look of innocence. Do you know the significance of those field reports, Major?" he asked. Steve smiled. "I suppose you are going to tell me the significance, General," Steve said. The general smiled. "As I investigated further into the agent's history, it turns out that she was an Amazon in origin that possessed superhuman powers and longevity. Also, I was able to find some portraits of her from the early 19th century and late 19th century. He pulled out the copies of the images from his briefcase and laid them on the table for all to see. The agent looks like our yeoman here. Not exactly alike, but the two women are related. And, as I had read through your field reports, I came across that you mentioned the name Hippolyta when you had encountered Solomon Grundy. The general stopped and smiled. You could see in his expression that he knew the truth, but he wanted to hear the words from our mouths. My telepathy had revealed that Steve wanted to tell him, but being a joker that Steve was, he had stretched out the reveal for as long as possible. The general had chuckled to himself. I see, you are going to make me work for it, aren't you? He asked jokingly. Okay, Major. I like suspense. I read mystery novels too. The identity of Wonder Woman has to be a closely guarded secret. I get that. But, if we are all going to be working together, I want to hear the words from you too. You can trust me. He spoke with such earnest and heartfelt honesty. I felt my eyes tearing up. It is okay, Steve Trevor. We can be honest with General Blankenship and Colonel Darnell. I said sincerely. The general sighed with relief because he thought it was going to be more difficult. Thank you, Yeoman, the general stated. Steve stood up and filled his cup with soda cola. We had wanted to tell you the other day, but felt that it could wait until after the field operations at the Iceberg Lounge had been completed, Steve said. To be honest, Steve, I had already known that Diana was Wonder Woman, Darnell stated. He paused. I had suspected it some time ago, but I did not act on it because I knew you two were in love, Darnell stated. The question now is, where do we go from here? I stated. The general looked at Steve and me with sincerity. Although, I know that Diana here is many centuries older than I am, I have come to think of you two as my children. I know that may seem non-military bearing like as one can be. I see the love in your eyes. I feel the connection between you two. That is why you two are successful together as field agents. I do not want to see that come to an end. He said. He paused. Well, at least until this war comes to an end. I see your place here at the War Department as a sign from the Creator. And, I welcome that reality. He said, where we go from here is that I want to make you a proper field agent. I want to promote the yeoman here to a rank of a commander. That way you and the Major can work side by side without the distraction of fraternization bearing its ugly head. I want you two to refine your cover story and maintain the secrecy of Diana's true identity. He stated, if only for a short time, I believe that we can do great things together. He said. We all paused to collect our thoughts. Anyone want more cold cuts? I asked. The men all seemed to find humor in my question and spent some time laughing. Well, I think that if we are going to be working together for the foreseeable future, then we need to bring the Colonel and General up to speed on the entire truth of the subject matter, I said. Steve looked towards me with interest. I agree. Diana can provide to you a detailed report on the entire matter from the last 2 months to bring you up to speed on the Nazi operations we had encountered, Steve said. I had reached out my arm to call the magic lasso. Themis, come to me, I commanded. In a flash of light the lasso had appeared before us, and in the second flash of light, the lasso had transformed into Nemesis. Since Themis and Nemesis were twin sisters, Steve could not readily tell them apart. Nemesis, 13 billion years old, was an attractive goddess. Unlike Themis, who had golden blonde hair, Nemesis had fiery red hair. She had a darker side to her personality than Themis. I do not wish to suggest that she had been an evil person or a person who was motivated by the self. I had always known Nemesis to be a kind-hearted, passionate woman, although she had to dispense justice by my hand. In celestial law, she was divine retribution. Likewise, Themis had been the side of celestial justice that leaned more towards the good or the person who was motivated by the others. Nemesis, it is wonderful to see you today, I said while kissing her on the cheeks. Nemesis smiled and kissed me back on the cheeks. Thank you, Athanata. You are always so polite and humble, she said. Nemesis was dressed in casual jeans and a white blouse with short sleeves. The shirt had been untucked, which served as a dress to conceal the waistline for the jeans. The men all had seemed to gravitate towards her beauty. General Blankenship, Colonel Darnell, and Steve Trevor, I would like to introduce you to Goddess Nemesis, I said. Nemesis extended her arm to greet the men in kindness. All three men received her arm and kissed her hand. I have to admit that I found the charm from all three men to be a bit of a surprise. I smiled. Thank you, gentlemen. Please, everyone, take your seats and relax, she said. Nemesis, I need for you to recall the events of the last 2 months for the general and colonel to see. I want you to tie into my journal to create a facsimile of the story. Do not worry, gentlemen. We will be in a pocket dimension and time will not pass for us inside the realm. I stated, for the next few hours in the pocket dimension, Nemesis recreated the events for the last 2 months as they are recorded in my journals. Combined, the stories require 2 hours to see the first story and 18 hours to see the second story. The events ended just as our party had gone to visit the brownstone estate of John Soder. The general and the colonel were amazed and astonished at how much detail had been presented in the narrations. Truly remarkable technology you have, Yeoman Prince, General Blankenship said. We all had left the pocket dimension once the stories had been completed. The men were amazed that only 1 minute had passed outside of the realm. 30 minutes after 12 o'clock. You know, I just realized that I forgot to get the pickles, I said. With the exception of Steve Trevor, the other two men were still in a state of shock after witnessing the stories from the last 2 months created by Nemesis as the magic lasso. Blankenship smiled. You forgot the pickles? I am going to have to demote you down to private for that blunder, Yeoman Prince, he joked. Darnell laughed. Leave it to the Navy to forget the importance of pickles, he said. We all laughed. Blankenship maintained his happy spirit, but the sense of respect for the work I had done in the last 2 months took on a whole new dimension for him. Yeoman Prince, forgive me, Commander Prince. The work you have done for the War Department the last 2 months after witnessing the facsimile from Goddess Nemesis here, just now, I find it difficult to utter the words. A thank you would seem pale in comparison to the deeds you have endured. Prior to this moment, I had only Major Trevor's report from the incidents. Their descriptions do not do you justice on the amount of sacrifice you have had to make. And believe me, I am a general and a leader of men in wartime. I know that you are superhuman, but the sexual assault and the brutal nature of the fight with Solomon Grundy cannot be easy to deal with internally. And Alan Scott's injuries in the altercation and your ability to treat his trauma in a timely manner are truly remarkable, he said. Blankenship paused. The events that I have witnessed today only serve to underscore why we must work together as a team. That way, you would get the full value of having your work documented, he said. I smiled. Thank you, General, for your kind words. It means a great deal to me that you value the work Steve and I have done on the behalf of the War Department, I said. I paused to collect my thoughts. To provide some perspective and context to our discussion today, General, it is necessary and sufficient for you to understand that I have been working on this task for 2,770 years, or roughly since I had been a 25-year-old woman. When I met Stephen Trevor on Paradise Island, time, he convinced me that helping his cause would be just. As a goddess of justice and a champion for humanity on Earth, I cannot directly interfere in the logistics for the war. The work for us immortals must be indirect with the individuals we are charged to help. Now, having said all that, I have worked with many generals over the years, including General Washington and General Bonaparte. My senses tell me that you are an honorable man and that you only seek to do justice for your country. Your word is good enough for me, I said. Blankenship smiled. Thank you, Commander. That does help me to put things in perspective and in context. I get your meaning. The work we are about to do will probably never be known by the general public, but it will serve to put this country on the right path to victory over the Axis power and tyranny, he said. I smiled. If you two men will entertain my suggestion, I propose that we complete our lunch today. I want to get back to the manor to review the mission at hand. I would like to create a brief for tomorrow afternoon. I want you two to come out to the manor and take a tour of the ship. This way, you can get a better sense of the technology at our disposal. Then, I want to propose adding some key people to our tactical team, I said. All the men looked at each other. I think that your proposal is a good one, Commander. I look forward to the meeting, Blankenship said. I smiled. I will call the Colonel and the General later today with a revised schedule for the time of the meeting. I believe it will be in the afternoon, but I want to give the staff at Wayne Manor adequate time to prepare, I stated. That will be satisfactory, Commander. I look forward to the meeting, Blankenship said. I too look forward to the meeting, Commander, Darnell said. All five of us took some time to finish the lunch of cold cuts. Nemesis relayed to me that she would be filling in for Themis for a few days. As I did not see any harm in that decision, I welcomed Nemesis' help. Our lunch had concluded and Steve, Nemesis, and I made our way back to the car to return to Wayne Manor. 1 o'clock in the afternoon. In the car, I had found myself dozing off again while laying my head on his side. I am not sure why I found myself behaving in such a manner, but it had felt comfortable. Steve had wrapped his right arm around my right shoulder and had been playing with my hair. Nemesis had been laying against my side. She had let me play with her hair. "I cannot believe we both had gotten a promotion, Steve," I said. "I know, Diana. I am still trying to wrap my head around all that has to happen this afternoon. I think the General and Colonel have found an all-new respect for the work you have done, Diana," he said. "Colonel Steve Trevor," I said as I had practice getting used to the title. He smiled. "I can get used to it, Commander Prince," Steve said jokingly. "I love the way you two mingle together. It is fun to watch. I hope that Themis finds that joy soon," Nemesis said. I smiled. "Do tell us what is happening with Themis. We are nosy," I said. She smiled. "Well, God Eros stopped by the house the other day, and we had talked. He told me how he had fallen for my sister, Themis." Of course, I had laughed at the pronouncement. "But I am not shocked. My sister is hot," Nemesis said. I laughed. "You're hot too, Nemesis," I stated. "I know that." She gave me a high five. "Anyway, after a long talk with my sister, she agreed to allow Eros to woo her," Nemesis said. "Good for her. Themis is a wonderful person," I said. Nemesis softly played with my forearms as she caressed her fingers only the hair on my arms. "I sense that your energy levels are low, Athanata," she said. I smiled. "I had a hard couple of days. I had to focus in the meeting to keep my concentration up," I said. "I had noticed, Athanata," she said. "I might arrange for a massage this afternoon," I said. "I can arrange that, Diana," Steve said. I smiled. The rest of the trip, we all had spent relaxing as Steve drove us to Wayne Manor.
Journal of Edgar Sisko, December 17, 1943, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. As stated before in my earlier journal entry, a car came around at my Pennsylvania laboratory at 10 o'clock in the morning. Then, the car traveled in a southerly direction from Lancaster County, PA to a destination in Nellis, West Virginia. The entire trip had taken about 7 hours by car. The area had been recently in the news due to an accident in one of the local mines. I have added a copy of the newspaper report into my journal for historical reference. Anticipating a long car drive, the driver had provided refreshments and food for the trip. I took the time to record this entry and to read the morning newspaper. The driver had been instructed to make frequent stops along the way that would provide for my comfort. Explosion toll of Nellis mine increases to 10. Rescuers recover bodies of 9 workers, other dies in hospital. Nellis, November 7, 1943. An explosion which rocked the number 3 Nellis mine claimed its 10th victim tonight, 17 hours after rescue workers had removed the bodies of 9 men killed in the second disaster in West Virginia this year. The explosion which killed 9 men outright and critically injured 2 others, added another casualty when Lawrence Vincent, 23, died in a Charleston hospital where he had been rushed shortly after his rescue last night from the blast-rocked mine. By 2 o'clock in the morning, 7 hours after the explosion, which occurred 2 days after work was resumed following the general shutdown because of wage negotiation differences, rescue workers had removed the victims from the captive mine operated by the American Rolling Mill Company. Company officials made preparations today to repair the damage, confined to one section, and to restore the mine to immediate operation. They said the explosion apparently had been caused by a spark from a coal-cutting machine which ignited a pocket of gas in the section where the 11 men were working. 17 others were in the mine at the time, but were digging in other sections and were not affected by the explosion. State Miner Chief Jesse Redyard, who had been called to Tennessee because of a family illness, was expected here later today to conduct an investigation of the blast, the second in West Virginia mines this year. 13 men lost their lives in a fire in Pusglove No. 15 mine near Morgantown last January. General Manager C.W. Connor reported that the accident would not prevent continued operation of the mine, but explained that the damaged area will not be worked until repairs are completed. He asserted that there was no great damage done to the mine. The dead: William H. Gunno, 48, foreman, wife and 4 children. Kester Gunno, 37, machine man, wife, and 3 children. William O. Workman, 43, motorman, wife and 3 children, including 2 sons in the armed services. Oualo Miller, 28, slate man, wife and 3 children. John Williams, 60, track man, wife and 7 children, including 2 sons in the service. Julius Domokes, 34, section foreman, wife and two children. Odell Linville, 37, loading machine operator, wife and seven children. Steve Turkovich, 48, slate man, wife and two children. John Setliff, 49, slate man, wife and three children. Lawrence Vincent, 23, slate man, wife. Condition critical. William C. Barker, 59, shot firer, one of the two injured miners rushed to McMillan Hospital at Charleston, was in a critical condition, suffering from shock and severe body burns. The normal employment of Nellis No. 3 is 260, but Superintendent A.E. Oakley said the blast occurred when only 28 were at work. Shortly after the explosion, which was so severe, it ripped clothing from the miners' bodies, a crowd of about 350 persons, including families and friends of those at work, gathered at the mine mouth and maintained a vigil until early this morning when the last bodies were removed. Today, this little Boone County mining town was quiet as mourning widows and children prepared for burial services. Most of the miners will be buried at Madison, although Connor said the body of Turkovich would be taken to Niles, Ohio, for interment. Charleston Gazette, West Virginia, November 8, 1943. I am not sure why the thought of adding this article to my journal had occurred to me. At the top of my head, I found it interesting that this random location I had been heading to had been the scene of a historical accident in recent days. Perhaps, it had been scientific interest that inspired my motives. I shall make an update to this journal when we arrive at our final destination later today. Asterisk, asterisk, asterisk.
One PM, April 21st, 2019. Chapter 1, April 9th, 1950. Diana's Journal. I would like to think of today as an interesting day. What should have been an uneventful day for me had turned out to be horrible. As I am sitting down to record this entry, my anxieties are high. It has only been a week since I had defeated the Titan Darkseid on the planet Apocalypse. In another universe, with the help of Roxy, the symbiote entity that joined with me to help defeat Darkseid, we freed all the Titans of that universe from their orbs that had imprisoned them for eons. After doing so, we used the Celestial Gate to transport back to my home on Earth. This next part is difficult for me to explain but necessary for this record. There are many parts to the narrative and must be told in a serial way. If required, I will make edits as my understanding of the phenomenon or the experience becomes further understood by me. Apocalypse side. I have decided to name the planet that served as the capital planet for the Dark Universe to be Planet Apocalypse. From what information I could learn from the 30 days I had been on the planet in that universe, it had been a future timeline when compared to the Earth of 1943. To prevent confusion, I will title my universe as the Ninth Universe. Why I chose 9 to be the title is because historically 9 is the number of magic, 9 is a sacred number, 9 is the number of completion and fulfillment, 9 is the symbol of wisdom and good leadership, and 9 is the number of heaven. Last, 9 is the Hebrew symbol of truth. After Roxy and I had freed the old Titans and restored balance to the Dark Universe and retrieved my daughter that Darkseid had stolen from my womb during our initial battle when he soundly defeated me, I used my healing powers to replace the embryo back into my womb. Goddess Athena, Dark Universe, helped me to perform the necessary rituals to restore my daughter's life to ensure the baby would not die. Together, we had stepped through the gate hoping to step through to the moment where I left Earth 9. The Creator had other plans for me. Earth 9 side. I should probably state that at this moment, my psychological state had been manic. My body is still sore from the beating I had undergone by Darkseid, and the second battle had been tough even though I had been the victor. Roxy's mental state had been filled with anxiety after spending eons down in that abyss. When we had materialized onto the Earth, it had been nighttime. We materialized right in the middle of Athens, Georgia in the United States in the year 1955 CE. How I had been able to determine this will be explained later in this narrative. At the moment we had materialized, I had not known this fact, and we appeared in the middle of a violent mob. At first, I did not know what the violent mob had been about. From my viewpoint, people were scattered about a small section of a small family farm. There had been large banners about the main stage that said, "End segregation now," and "Meta humans rights now." There had been some gunfire all over the field. Many of the citizens were ducking for cover to avoid being hit by stray bullets. "Diana, what is this?" Roxy asked. "I do not know, but we need to help these people and help the police to secure the area. Transform into symbiote form until we know more." As before, we merged into one being. When I left the Earth 30 days ago, I had left all my armor and weapons behind in the Nazis' bunker. I hope that someone had been able to secure it. Edit. I feel that it is important that when I recorded this entry the night after the farm incident that my sense of time had been based on leaving the Earth 30 days ago. To avoid confusion to the reader, I kept that mindset for my journal record. I focused on remaining calm and decided to go with my instincts and make a scan of the area with my truth vision. While I had made the scan, I had transported myself to a pocket dimension to suspend time and make a detail scan. As this had been the first time Roxy had experienced this aspect of my powers, let's just say, it freaked her out. "Diana, what is going on?" "I am making a scan of the area with my truth vision to learn what is going on before we start smacking the wrong people in the head." I started to make a scan when Goddess Athena appeared before me. I bowed before my goddess. "Athenata, I am so happy to see you." She gave me an incredible embrace. Keep in mind that I did not know it had been 5 years since Goddess Athena had seen me. I felt kind of weird that Athena would hug me in such a way. She had never done so before in these types of meetings. "Athena, what is going on?" "I am not sure where to start, Athenata, but the short version of the story is that the world thinks that you have been dead for the past 5 years. The Allies won the war against the Axis powers in 1945. The United States is at war with the communist forces of North Korea. And you have materialized in the middle of a political dispute between citizens about the treatment of black citizens and meta-human citizens in the United States. The newspapers call it segregation." I think in the midst of my shock that my coping mechanism had been to go straight to sarcasm. "No, my goddess, I mean, what is happening here in the field?" Goddess Athena looked at me with her silvery eyes and just gave me a hug. My heart really started to flutter because Athena gave me a hug that said, "I am sorry to be the one to tell you this, but I apologize, Athenata. If you ever had faith in me, daughter, then it will truly be tested this day." What started out as a peaceful demonstration for a change to current law in Georgia has turned into a violent mob. "I want you to help the law enforcement agents secure the environment and do it without hurting anyone." I bowed at her command. "Yes, my goddesses will be done. We will talk later, Athenata. I promise. There is much you need to learn this day." "Oh, one more thing, Athenata." Before I knew what was happening, Athena took my arms up into hers and returned my old bracers back onto my arms. "Thank you, Mother." Goddess Athena turned and vanished out of the pocket dimension. Edit. I have decided to add this entry now in the record. When I left Earth 9, it had been the April 11th, 1945. 5 years. Edit. Entry made December 26th, 1955. I make this update at this point in the record to establish that unknown to me, the Immortal Council of Elders had asked to withhold certain information from me to prevent an anomaly from happening in the timeline. 1. 6 p.m. April 25, 2019. Diary of Dottie West. Dated April 9, 1950. Edit. Dottie West. After further thinking and talking it over with Athenata, "Diana, I felt that I needed to do my part to help record the events that transpired on our farm on April 9, 1950. I had made some entries into my diary on the day of the event. After reading some of the entries that Athenata had made in her journal, I wanted to try at recording my perspective too. My entry here had been made several weeks later after the original event. I will try to remember it as best that I can. Today was an incredible day here at the farm. It started out as a quiet day in the morning, and it had been quiet in the afternoon, but in the evening is when all hell broke loose. Well, today had been the big day for the rally. Rick Sanders, the person who organized the event, asked Daddy if he could host the event at the farm, as our farm has a big open area just west of the main apartment buildings and boutique. It is perfect for constructing a temporary platform for hosting bands and podiums for public speakers. The event was for the purpose of helping to bring awareness to public officials that want to propose a change to the laws about segregation in Athens, Georgia and the greater Clark County. Well, you just know that this was not a popular topic by many people here. Since, I was a young girl, which had been through most of the depression in the 1930s and teenager in the 1940s. This debate has been going on for a mighty long time. I do not know this for a fact, but I believe that there are just as many color folks that live in Athens than there are white folks. And being a college town and all, many folks were thinking that now was the time for a change. Rick had talked my daddy Gus into letting them stage the rally at the farm because they could not get a permit to have it in town because the town officials felt it would be too sensitive of a topic and could not guarantee the safety of the citizens. My daddy and Rick have known each other for a long time. Rick had worked at our farm over the years to help make money to go to law school. Daddy, a Republican, had been sensitive to Rick's problem and felt that he had the right to assemble and all that stuff as anyone else did and was not going to let a detail of permit prevent a friend from speaking his mind. One thing you can count on by folks from Athens, GA, is they do speak their minds. My mother, maybe Eileen, always called this hollering. I should mention that she has been deceased for 5 years now, God bless her soul. I always like to mention her whenever I can. And she is the one who helped Daddy run the farm until she died. I miss her. She is the one who taught me the value of writing your thoughts down on paper. She called it, get them demons out of your head. You will have to mind my grammar as I have never really been fancy with the words, but I do think I am good at recording my meaning. That is probably something I should change as I have dreams of being a singer in Nashville. But that is a topic for another time. Anyway, Rick talked us into hosting the rally. I thought the idea had been perfect because I could perform with my band. The band is nothing fancy, just me and a couple of guys in a bluegrass county band playing a few tunes for the folks here. There had been a lot of bands there that day. A couple of vendors had set up tents, and some of the local church folks set up stands to sell freshly baked pies for the audience. The big hit at the party had been the cupcakes that Ann Johnson had made. She runs the local bakery near the farm, and of course, cheap beer won the day, and some local stuff the people make on their own farms. Daddy prefers the local homemade spirits to the store-made stuff. For the most part, the day had been peaceful. Well, I guess that the booze and hot spring day had set the conditions for the folks because while I had been on stage singing my heart out and strumming my banjo, all heck hit the fan. I don't know how it started or why. I think it was just some young folks being stupid, but anyway, people started fighting. I just stayed on stage and kept playing my banjo with the boys. Next thing I know, gunshots started ringing all over the place. I had ducked for cover as well as all the guys had done. I am not saying we were cowards, but I had rather be alive than lying dead on the ground. I looked around and saw a terrible thing and people were fighting everywhere. I prayed to God to get us through this. And that is when I turned my head and saw the strangest thing ever. At first, I didn't know what to make of it. I saw a white streak of light come all the way down from the sky, like a falling star from heaven. It landed over by the trees along the north side of the field going back to the farmhouse along the road. Out of the light came this woman. She had been surrounded by bright white light. She had wings of an angel that came off her backside. Her face had dark black stains. I am not sure if they are stains, but I cannot think of the proper term for them. Anyway, her face and body had been covered with black stains or paint that pretty much covered her fancy woman parts, as some folks say. Strangely, she had looked beautiful to me. She had walked out of the light and had seemed confused for a bit. She had looked around the field to get a sense of what had been going on. Her eyes had turned bright blue as she looked around. She paused for a moment as if she had been talking to someone. Then she waved her arms to the sides and lifted off the ground like an angel. Her eyes turned a shade of red. She looked like she meant business. She flew around the field with grace and beauty with her white wings all about. Her manner had been deliberate. Her means had been swift, and her method had been kind. Not sure how to describe it all, but I will try. She lifted her hands and white flames, or smoke, came flying out from around her body. The fancy fire melted all the guns that were all around the field. It had been amazing to watch because she had not aimed at any one specific person. It had looked like she had concentrated in her mind and then had extended her arms out from her torso, and then a blue energy wave or ball had come from her body. As the wave flew out like a wave in the river water does when you toss a rock into the water, the blue wave did that too. All the guns had melted and had ceased to work. All the crowd of people gathered around had the look of awe on their faces as I looked around the field. The sheriff, the band, the concessions folks, and my daddy. I turned my head and saw my dad had been in a scrap with a few folks. At first, he had been holding his own, and then a couple of more guys ran there to subdue him. I had been very afraid for him. I shouted out, "Daddy!" The woman had flown over to where he had been, and her eyes changed to a brighter shade of red and she started smacking all those guys around. She had used her feet, her arms, and her fists and had made short work of them folks. As she had helped my father off the ground, her eyes turned a pretty shade of green. She had examined his arm with her hands and eyes and then what looked like green vapor came out of her hands and seemed to heal all his injuries. Then, some of the guys that had been leading the violence tried to fight with her, but she just knocked them out one at a time. The sheriff had been in a scrap and the crowd had seemed to overwhelm him. I was concerned for his safety. She flew over there like a demon child and smacked those boys all around and it seemed that as her eyes changed a deeper red, some of them boys got really scared of her. I found myself kind of cheering for her. The sheriff had thanked her for helping him get off the ground. She smiled and looked around for people to help out. Then, she helped some folks off the ground and had made sure they could get to safety. She had cleared the way for the county law enforcement people so that they could get onto the property and secure the area. It had taken some time for the police to get the crowd under control. I would say about an hour or so. Surprisingly, no one had been hurt. The local folks assumed her to be one of them metahuman folks that you read about in the newspapers, but I think she had been something else. My daddy had been the first person to approach her. She had seemed to change her attire from last demon from hell look to more princess from the beach style. Both looks were hot. She was wearing what looked like battle armor that barely covered her breast and hip areas. She turned a lot of heads of the guys trying to make it to their cars to go home for the night. Rick had continued to see to it that people made it home safely from the event. He told Gus that he would take care of it and that we should go on down to the house to rest for the night. The police had us make out some reports which did take some time. The woman had answered some of the police questions and seemed to be very kind in her demeanor. I had decided to go up and talk to her myself. I felt my heart sink in my chest as I reached my hand out and said, "Hi, I'm Dottie West. Welcome to Athens, Georgia." After I realized what I just did, I kind of felt stupid. She smiled and held her hand out. "Hello, I am Diana Prince. Thank you for your kindness, Dottie." Her voice had been so soft and calm. A voice of an angel is what I felt. She stood about 5 feet 9 inches and had rich black hair. She had the prettiest blue eyes I had ever seen. They were mesmerizing. The more she spoke to me, the calmer I had felt. Also, she had been the fittest woman that I had ever met in my life. She had been muscular as if she had spent her whole life working out at the gym. She was not over muscular, but she looked like those Viking women you see in the movies. Not to make myself seem evil or bad, I felt kind of jealous. "You do not have to feel jealous, Dottie," she said. "Wow, you read my mind, Diana." She smiled and laughed. My father had walked to us and smiled. "Thank you, miss," he asked. "My name is Diana Prince, or at least, I used to be," she said in a real kind voice. Daddy seemed confused by her answer. "Do you not know who you are now?" he asked jokingly. She smiled. "This is going to sound strange to you and I do not really have an explanation, but only 30 days ago, I had been in the south of France fighting a Nazi fort along the Swiss Alps and now, I have been informed that it is 5 years later," she said rather kindly. My father seemed to not know how to respond to that and offered his hand in kind. "Look, Diana, you really did us a big favor tonight by showing up when you did. My daughter, Dottie here has kind of told me how you arrived. A streak of light from heaven is how she described it. I saw what you did to help the people, the police, and Dottie back there. I cannot explain it either, but I do not think you are lying to us. Weirdly, I feel that I can trust you. Come on down to the house with us and we can talk it over with some coffee," he said. "Thank you. My name is Stephen Gustafson West, but people call me Gus for short. We own the small cotton farm you have stumbled upon." Daddy opened the door to the pickup truck and offered a hand for the lady so she could enter the truck. "Don't worry, Diana. Strange women falling out of the sky in their bathing suits at a country rally on a hot spring night and then smacking a few boys' heads is sadly not the weirdest thing that has ever happened to us in Athens, GA," Gus said jokingly. She smiled and took a seat in the truck and I sat next to her. She smelled wonderful. Her body had been warm as I sat next to it in the truck. It only took a few minutes to drive down to the farmhouse that sat pretty much in the center of the farm. "Our farm is only a small 300-acre lot. We have a small barn for horses and small animals to grow simple foods on the farm. They are nothing fancy, but they help get us by in slow economic times." "Well, Daddy parked the truck and all of us jumped out of the truck. Our dog Bo had come running out of the house and met us all at the front porch. Bo seemed to take a liking to Diana as she made her way to the steps leading onto the porch. She knelt over and ran her hands along.